When you hear the words exciting, grand, adventure, incredible, fascination, wild ride, what do you think of? Maybe think of an amusement park? Passenger seat while Jean's driving. Yeah, you know what? Dwayne might say the same thing, only not about Jean. Anyone else, something that you think of as you think of those words, exciting, grand, adventure, incredible, fascination, wild ride? Thought of Corey and Carrie and their family, and I thought, well, they were in a very fascinating place this past week. Very amazing place. I'm sure you saw things that you probably haven't quite seen that way before. It's very fascinating. We may think of exciting places that we visited. Or you might have think of things that you've done, maybe the satisfaction of completing a project. I had to think of the fascination of a newborn baby, just after they're born, and you see the fingers and the toes, and it's just there's something that just draws you in, and fascination that this little being was inside, and now it's there. It's incredible. Maybe some of you have been watching the Olympics this past week, and It's really interesting to see the ability that people have on skates and snowboards and skis and luge and all those things. It's quite incredible. It's quite a wild ride as well, and it's pretty fascinating. Maybe some of you are fascinated with the lives of the rich and famous. You think that they have very exciting lives, and maybe when you look at their lives, you think that your life is quite boring compared to them. But have you ever thought of those words in association with following Jesus? Have you ever thought of using those words to describe your walking and your living with Jesus? This past week, in my reading, I read a number of readers or people who used these words to describe their life in Christ. They used phrases like grand adventure with God. There was another one that said, the wild ride of redemption. I like that. One of my friends sent me an email, and in the email she said that faith is passed on by fascination. That phrase caught me, and I've had to think about it. Faith is passed on by fascination. And we hear of God's incredible plan. Those phrases, as I read them, they grabbed me, and I thought, those adjectives, love the adjectives that were used. All in relationship to our walk with God. Is this how we think? Do we think of those words when we think of God and following Christ as a grand adventure, as a wild ride, as incredible? They might not be words that we'd use. Maybe they're not even words that we've thought of using. Are they words you might think about maybe someone else's life? Someone else's life is incredible or fascinating. But maybe some of us can even think we're missing out on some of those things because we have to live a life for Jesus, a life that's not as exciting, a life maybe that we don't think is a grand adventure compared to other people. The last weeks we've talked about who we are, really. When it comes down to the very core of our being, who am I? And as we've talked about that, we've discovered that who we are is defined most truly in relationship with Jesus. We are God's sons. We are God's daughters. And not only that, we are dearly loved sons and daughters of God. God is pleased with us. And that is something that Satan does not want us to believe. He doesn't want us to grab a hold of that identity and live out of it. And last week, or 2 weeks ago, we talked about temptations. If you're really the Son of God, prove it. Turn these stones into bread. Are you really? Are we really dearly loved children of God? Is God really pleased with us? Satan tries to tempt us and deceive us so that we will doubt that identity, that we'll doubt who we are, that we'll compromise our beliefs, that we'll doubt that God is really able to do what he says he can do. And Satan tries to trap us and blind us with addictions, with distractions that keep us away from all that God has for us. And he says things like he tempted Jesus, do things my way, and you're going to have fun. You're going to have success. You're going to have happiness. Very tempting. Satan doesn't want us to live out our identity as dearly loved children of God. And that's so important in knowing that that is who we are. I really want to stress that. That is who we are. Yes, we are moms, we are dads, we are farmers, we are all of these other things. But the core of our identity as followers of Jesus is that we are dearly loved sons and daughters of God. And when we see that, then we're also able to see a little more clearly why we are here and what we're supposed to do. And we're going to be moving on into those questions in the next weeks. We see more clearly why we're here and what we're supposed to do as we look at God, as we look at his eternal purposes, as we look at Jesus and look at what Jesus came to do. And today we're looking at a story from Matthew chapter 4, verses 17 to 22. And I'm going to invite Ben and Logan and Wyatt to come and read that story.
Turn from your sins and turn to God, because the kingdom of heaven is near.
One day, as Jesus was walking along the shore beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers,
Simon, also called Peter,
and Andrew,
fishing with a net, for they were commercial fishermen.
Jesus called out to them,
"Come, be my disciples, and I will show you how to fish for people."
And they left their nets at once and went with him.
A little further up the shore, he saw two other brothers,
James and John,
sitting in a boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets.
And he called them to come too.
They immediately followed him, leaving the boat and their father behind. I'm sorry, I read your line.
Those are great verses, a great story, very familiar. We're going to actually look at this story, this very familiar story, in two parts. So we're going to be looking at it again next week. Today we want to look at the first part. In Matthew 4:17, we hear Jesus, his message, why he's here, what he came to do. And he says, turn from your sin and turn away from your sin and turn to God. In my NIV, it says, repent. Turn from your sin and turn to God, because the kingdom of God is near. We've talked about repent and repentance many times in the past. It means change direction. Change the way you're going. The way you're going is the wrong way. We were in Winnipeg years ago, and we were going to my cousin's, and we were following my mom and dad. They were ahead of us, and we made a left-hand turn at this big major intersection. And all of a sudden, we're driving along on this side of the median, and they're along on the other side of the median, and we're both going in the same direction. They were on the wrong side. They had to repent. They had to turn around and go the right way. Go back and go around and come the right way. The way that we're, and that's the same as us. We're called to repent, to change direction. Why are we going the wrong way? Because we're part of a world that has turned away from God. We've turned against God. We've turned away from the way God meant this world to be, the way he's meant for us to be. We've embraced the lies of Satan, and we've selfishly chosen to go our own way. But it's not the right way. Not the right way. And Jesus says, repent, change direction, because the kingdom of God is near. The kingdom of God is here. And I'm going to use the term kingdom of God. In Matthew, he uses kingdom of heaven. It's interchangeable. The reason he uses heaven is because the people he's writing to, and they avoided using the word God. It wasn't a word that they said often, because God was so holy and you didn't use his name. So he said kingdom of heaven, but it's interchangeable. The kingdom of God is God's reign, and it's a reign of justice and healing and forgiveness and love and peace. And now God says he's coming in Jesus Christ to make things right. This world that we're in that isn't right, he's come to make it right. So repent. And as I was reading this week, John Higgle writes, rethink and revise everything about your lives in light of this new thing that God is doing. But how? How do we repent? How do we change direction? Well, in the story, we see Jesus going for a walk along the Sea of Galilee. And he sees these guys, Peter, Andrew, James, and John. They're fishermen. They're fishing. They're fishermen just like their father, probably like their grandfather before him, and maybe their great-grandfather before him. This is a family business. This is what they do. This is what their lives look like. They're fishermen. This is what they expect the rest of their lives are going to look like. They're going to live out their lives fishing. They have no plans to change. But Jesus calls them. He says, Peter, Andrew, James, and John, come follow me, and I will show you how to fish for people. This time, as I read this story, they didn't ask, follow you where? Where are we going? We're not told that they stopped to ask their father, see what he thought. It's incredible. They dropped their nets, as they leave their boats, they leave their father, they leave their family business to follow Jesus. Why? Why did they do it? Would you, if you were them? Bill, Corey, Ben, get out of your tractor and come follow me. Why? Where are you going to take me? What would cause you to actually respond? Jesus isn't a stranger to them. In John's Gospel, John tells us that John the Baptist had actually pointed Jesus out to some of them as the Lamb of God. In Luke's account, Luke has Jesus calling them after Jesus there's been this miracle of a great amount of fish in their nets. Matthew doesn't mention any of that in his account. So they do know a little bit about Jesus, but they don't know Jesus like we know Jesus. They don't have the Bible. None of that other past Matthew chapter 4 has happened yet. They don't have this. They don't know this the way we know it. So why would they drop everything? Leave their father, leave their business, their security, their well laid out plans for the future to follow Jesus. A few things that I thought of, you may think of some other things. I wonder if there was just something about Jesus that drew people to him. And when my friend wrote that phrase to me early this week that said, faith is passed on by fascination, got me thinking, was there something about Jesus that fascinated them? That was appealing to them? That compelled them to respond? Have you ever thought of Jesus that way? Something maybe about him? This was someone who would cause you to change your plans? Drop what you were doing? Change your life? When Peter, Andrew, James, and John looked up at the sound of his call that day, did they hear something beyond just the words, follow me? Did they see something in his eyes that just drew them to him? Something in his manner? They had no idea what they were getting themselves into. They really didn't know what follow me meant the way we do. They were only invited to follow me, and they responded. I also thought about it that Jesus' call, I believe, is authoritative. It demands a response. We have a choice. You can say yes, you can say no. And I think of other calls in the Bible. And in particular, I was thinking about the call of Abraham. God calls Abraham. He says, leave your country, leave your family, leave behind what's familiar, and come to a country that I will show you. Doesn't tell him even where it is ahead of time. I will show you. And again, Abraham, surprisingly, gets up and goes, even though he has no idea where he's going, what he's getting himself into. I'm not sure it even makes sense. It's not something that, some of you guys maybe are analytical, try to make sense out of this. It's not something you can make sense out of. Peter, Andrew, James, and John, or Abraham, don't go because they're forced to go. But there's something about that call, something about God, that causes Abraham to respond, causes the disciples to respond. I've had to think of Judas this week. Judas also responded when Jesus called him. We aren't told about his particular call, but he responded. He became a follower of Jesus. But it didn't make sense to him at all either. And later on, he turns away and he rejects. He makes a choice. So they respond. But what does follow me mean? What does it mean? Well, I think that when you see in those times, rabbis had followers. And it meant that they were their disciples. It was like an apprentice. So Jesus is inviting them to be his disciples, to be apprentices. They would go with him. They would be with him. Learn to do what he does. Learn to become what he is. I had to think of Graham. Graham's almost finished his apprenticing. When Graham hurt his arm and couldn't go to work, they weren't expecting him to come in. And that first day he went into work and they said, why are you here? You can't work. And he said, yes, but I can still watch. I can still carry a little bit with my other hand. And I can see what you're doing. I can still learn. And as long as it's all right with you that I'm here, I will be here. That's what an apprentice does. They watch. They learn. By doing it, but also by watching. Jesus just calls his disciples as apprentices. What does Jesus do that they're supposed to learn? Well, at this point, they really don't know. They don't know very much about what they're getting into. And remember again, they haven't heard the Sermon on the Mount yet. They haven't seen the miracles or the healings and all of that stuff. But there's something about Jesus himself, something that draws them to him, something that will change their lives. And it's amazing to me that Peter and Andrew and James and John, they head out with Jesus on this unknown journey that turns out to be quite the wild ride and quite an incredible adventure. They didn't know that when they gave up everything, that they would gain the world. Just a few things I want you to notice. Something drew them to Jesus. The Holy Spirit also stirs in our hearts today to draw us to Jesus. We come just as we are. Jesus accepts us just as we are. You know, young people struggle with being accepted, with fitting in. Jesus accepts you. You fit in with Jesus. He wants you just the way you are. You don't have to have it all figured out. You don't have to have all your questions answered. You don't need to know a lot. Next week, we're going to look at the rest of Jesus' statement. Jesus calls you and accepts you just the way you are. Second, the response meant giving themselves to Jesus. They left their nets behind to follow. There was change. John Higgle, who I was reading this week, says, whatever their personal agendas might have been, from now on their lives are about something God is doing. They're used to living for themselves. Now they will live for God. Before, they made plans according to their ambition and common sense. Now they're following God's command and working out where they'll fit into God's plan. Their self-concept changes. Before, they would say, I'm my own man. Now they would say, God has called me and I belong to him. Happens over time, doesn't happen all at once. But in saying yes to follow comes a response of some kind. And third, this is why we are here. This is why we are here. We are here on this earth. This is what we were made for, to be followers of Jesus, to walk with him, to be in relationship with him. This is the life that you were created for. Every person I believe it. Every person that is born on this earth was made to be a follower of Jesus. I don't know how it all works out, but I believe we were. We make a choice whether we will or not. Try to think of what it could describe it like. How do you describe that our lives are made to live for Jesus and that that's the most incredible, wild ride, fascinating way we can possibly live? I don't know if these examples are very good, but I was thinking about a house, living in a house with no windows. And you're having a good time and you're eating good food and there are other people there and everything's great. But you have no idea that there's a world out there, much more than what's just inside that house. Or maybe you have your BMW and you drive it in low gear between the house and the shed. You don't realize that you can drive all over the place, go all kinds of distances, driving over 200 kilometers per hour. Somewhere along the line, I hope you catch the picture that we sometimes look out there and think the world has more fun. There's something about, you know, that draws us. That's Satan tempting us. A life lived for Christ. In following him, it's what we were made for. Remember the movie The Matrix? Everyone thought they were going about their daily lives the way life was, but they were plugged into a machine, into the Matrix. It was a simulated reality. And when Neo got unplugged, that's really when he was free from that dream world. Science fiction. But that story came to my mind again as I was thinking about this week. Our world isn't the way it's supposed to be. It's still good because God made it, but it's not functioning the way it's supposed to be. And we're called out of the world, out of those systems. We're called to repent, to change direction, to follow Jesus. And Taylor, as the youngest, actually the boys here, as the youngest ones here, you have no idea what that all means yet, a little bit. As we get older, we learn a little bit more and a little bit more. But we're just called to come. Follow me, he says. Follow me. Become part of my kingdom. Start living the way God intended. It's incredible. It is exciting. We don't know where it will take us. There will be ups and downs. Not promising life is going to be perfect and that everything is going to be fine. We know that it's not. But as we follow Jesus, we learn a whole new way of being and living in our world, the way we were meant to be. And the first step is to answer Jesus' grand invitation to follow me. Let's pray together. Oh God, I thank you so much that you continue to call us to follow you. You continue to teach us. You continue to stir in our hearts. Continue to mold us and make us. You continue to change us from those ways, those habits that are so easy to become more and more like you. Lord, I pray this morning that we may become a little bit more fascinated with who you are. Lord, that we may think about it and struggle with what it means to live out of following you and what that means. What we were made for, especially for the young people, oh God, especially for the young people, I pray this morning, with their questions, with their struggle, trying to fit in, find their place in this world. Lord, I pray that something in the scriptures or something that I've even said or something that the Holy Spirit will stir within them will cause them to think a little bit more, be drawn a little bit more, be fascinated a little bit more, to explore more what it means to walk with you. God, I just pray that you will take this message and these words and use them for your honor and glory in each of our lives. Walk with us this week again, I pray. Surprise us with what you have in store for us. May we continue to be lights for you, O Jesus, I pray, as we reach out through our words and through our actions to others. And Lord, I pray that the fascination of Jesus may even be seen in us, that others will be drawn to you through us. Thank you, O God, for your word. Thank you for your call. Thank you for this time together. Thank you for this family of God. Pray your blessing on each one in Jesus' name.